This is the 14th time that we invite a world-leading philosopher or cognitive scientist to give the Pufendorf lectures. And our aim when we invite people to these lectures is to find persons who have whose work has shaped the debates in the debates of relevance to any of our three disciplines, practical philosophy or theoretical philosophy or cognitive science. As many of you may know, there are two topics for which Michael Bratman's work has been particularly important. One is the nature of intentions and individual actions. For many decades, the dominant view of intentions was Donald Davidson's theory that, well, Donald Davidson's view that intentions had no important or independent role to play for human agency. In his view, intentions were nothing but complexes of beliefs and desires. Michael Bratman's work in the 80s changed this by focusing the role intentions may have for cross-temporal and interpersonal coordination. He showed that the previously dominant view was oversimplified. The second topic is collective agency. Anyone working on questions about what the collective action is or about the distinction between collective actions and mere sets of intertwined or parallel actions will have to relate to Michael Bratman's sophisticated theory of shared agency. I'm sure that the planning theory of intention and the theory of shared agency will figure in various ways in the four talks that we are about to hear. I also know that we will have the privilege of hearing Michael Bratman's most recent lines of thought on the norms that seem to govern planning agency. And I'm very much looking forward to this. Please, Michael.
Thank you, Bjorn. I very much appreciate that kind introduction. Can everyone hear me? I'm a little bit struggling with a cold, so tell me if I'm breaking up. It's just an honor to be here. I really appreciate the invitation from the department to give these lectures and looking forward to these 4 days together. Before I jump into the lectures themselves, I'm going to tell you a little bit about why I wrote them, because that's in the background and I wanted you to know about it. It's a bit of autobiography, but it's helpful, I think. In the 70s and 80s, as Bjorn was saying, and against a background of work by Donald Davidson and under the influence of important work by Gilbert Harman and to some extent Hector Neyri Castaneda and the great social scientist Herbert Simon, I came to the view that our practical thinking is shaped in characteristic ways by our plans. And this is a key to understanding the striking forms of cross-temporal organization that are central to human agency. Somewhat stable prior partial plans normally provide a background framework within which much of our practical thinking, including the weighing of reasons, proceeds. As we might say, our practical thinking is almost always already embedded in a temporally extended framework of prior partial plans and the planned temporally extended activity that it supports. This framework providing role of these prior partial plans involves distinctive rationality norms, norms of consistency, coherence, stability. And a fruitful way to understand intention is to see intentions as planned states in this plan-infused psychic economy. In this way, we can develop what I like to call a naturalistically plausible and modest theory of the will. I developed these ideas in a book I published in 1987, and then I explored two further ideas. The first was that this planning framework provides resources for a rich model of our shared acting and thinking, a model that occupies a place in the space between work of, among others, John Searle and Gilbert and Margaret Gilbert. This led to a series of papers that eventually led to the book that Bjorn was alluding to that was published in 2014. The second idea was that this planning framework provides resources for a rich model of what I like to call our self-governance, one in the space between the work of, among others, Harry Frankfurt and Gary Watson. This led to a series of papers that got published in a volume in 2007, and it supported what I called an intention-based model of self-governance. And these developments about shared agency, so we have temporally extended agency, shared agency, self-governance, the idea is that the planning structures are behind all that. The idea is that our capacity for planning agency is, in that sense, a core capacity that supports a wide range of important practical capacities. That's the picture. But unrest was brewing. Why are the norms to which I was appealing norms of rationality, which I kept saying they were? In my book, I proposed a kind of two-tier justification with a structure similar to rule utilitarianism or rule consequentialism, but I also tried to block worries, famous worries, about such two-tier theories that go back to Jack Smart's worries about so-called rule worship. But the more I thought about it after the book, the less confident I was about this two-tier story. And also a deeper worry loomed. There was a terrific couple of papers by Hugh McCann in the 80s that responded to some early work of mine that went into this book. It challenged the very idea that these norms of consistency and coherence of plan really were norms of rationality rather than kind of rules of thumb, kind of convenient ways of tracking what really mattered. And then related, it's really interesting, that was Hugh McCann in the 80s. More recently, Joseph Roz and Niko Kolodny have developed very similar, but kind of developed further similar criticisms that led them to the thought that these norms are really just a myth. I will be calling the views of Roz and Kolodny in the lectures myth theories. At the same time, others, and this goes back to Harman's original work and includes work by David Velleman and Kieran Setia, to some extent Jay Wallace, were developing the idea that these norms that I emphasize, norms of plan, consistency, and coherence, and so on, are really norms of theoretical rationality. They're really kind of riding piggyback on norms of belief consistency and belief coherence. I call that view cognitivism about these norms. Now, I didn't believe either cognitivism or the myth theory. But I also didn't think that my treatment in that book was adequate to these challenges, which, after all, preceded the challenges, so give me a break, you know? So I had a problem. And I was led, because of worrying about that problem, to a series of papers started about a decade ago, in which I tried to work out a more adequate response to these challenges to the underlying norms of the planning theory. Oh, there's John. Hi, John. Hey, John. And these efforts over this past decade, not quite a decade, but close to it, had two main threads to them. One was the idea that a planning agent's self-governance involves a kind of coherence that these norms of rationality were, in a sense, tracking. So that's going to be one of the ideas I'm going to pursue today. And the other was that we really needed to do more work about a norm of what I called in the book plan stability, a diachronic norm, a norm of stability or constancy over time. In the book I had, this 87 book, I had a certain approach to that, which I still think that I'll tell you about later, but it increasingly seemed to me not fully adequate. And it also increasingly seemed to me very important because, in a way, the worry is what's, as it were, the diachronic glue that's holding all this planning stuff together over time, where that glue seems to play a very important role in the kind of deep structure of our temporally extended and social agency. Okay, that's where I was when I got this wonderful email from Bjorn honoring me with an invitation to give these lectures. And so I thought, okay, this is it. This is my chance to pull these things together to see if I can come up with a more adequate response to these challenges, to the idea that these are norms of rationality that are underlying this the structure of ideas that of planning at the basis of cross-temporal organization, social organization, and self-governance. So that's what I decided I would do for these lectures, and that's what I'm going to try to do here. So that's the background. Now let's begin. So what I'm going to say now is going to duplicate some of the things I just said, but they bear repeating, so I'll do that. So we're planning agents. The planning structures that infuse our agency involve a characteristic rational dynamics. We adjust our plans over time in light of our beliefs in the direction of satisfying rational constraints of plan consistency and means and coherence. And our plans are responsive to rational pressures in favor of stability over time. Our plans are, in a sense, we need better to understand rational defaults. This rational dynamics is, I believe, at the heart of, well, it was at the heart of the planning theory that I developed in this early work and that I just described to you. According to this theory, intentions, unlike the picture that Bjorn just described to you as Donald Davidson's early view, intentions are planned states. Given our cognitive and epistemic limits, these plans will normally be partial. I mean, it's a mistake to think that in planning we have to figure everything out before we can get started, right? Okay. In search of coordinating and organizing our practical thought and action at a time and over time, and as well as socially, we settle in advance on partial and to a large extent future-directed plans and fill them in as time goes by. Think about travel plans where you have partial plans and you gradually fill them in as time goes by. These, to some extent, stable prior partial plans guide our downstream thought and action. Oh, I guess I have to get a ticket now. I guess I better make a reservation for the airport shuttle. Okay. They pose problems of means and preliminary steps, problems whose solutions involve filling in these partial plans over time. They filter options that are potential solutions to those problems. They thereby help frame further deliberation and planning in ways that cohere with our limits, our resource limits. This is a great theme of Herbert Simons, and help support basic forms of cross-temporal and social organization. This plan-infused thinking normally extends over time and supports sustained planned temporally extended activities. These forms of functioning involve first personal practical thinking that's guided by these norms. While these norms can admit of qualification, we treat them not merely as useful rules of thumb, but as norms with a kind of independent significance. This involves characteristic dispositions to see violations of these norms as mistakes or breakdowns. Just think about your reaction when you realize that your plans involved having lunch with your friend and also having a dentist appointment. It's the oh darn it reaction, right? Okay. Now, the primary aim of the planning theory that I've been sketching just now is to provide descriptive and explanatory resources for understanding forms of practical functioning central to human agency. Resources available both within philosophy and other disciplines. So it's an ambitious picture of this is a structure within which to understand a wide range of phenomena about human agency, not just in philosophy, but elsewhere. In trying to understand these phenomena, however, we shouldn't rest content simply with a kind of positivistic model within which, as a matter of fact, thought and action are guided by certain planning norms. After all, we're modeling our own agency. We're not just studying a quaint species that plans a lot. So we want to know whether these norms would survive our critical reflection. Indeed, if these norms wouldn't survive our critical reflection, then these structures of planning agency would prima facie tend to be unstable for agents who are, as we are, reflective. Such an inherent instability in the psychological economy of planning agency would suggest that the planning theory may well fail to cut up the psychology at its joints. And this would pose a challenge to the claim of the planning theory that these planning structures are basic explanatory structures for agents like us. So we want to provide, if we can, a justification of these norms, one that's addressed to planning agents like us, planning agents for whom the reflective stability of these norms is a live issue. In this way, while the basic model of planning agency aims to be broadly naturalistic, there's an important interaction between the explanatory and the normative. A full defense of the explanatory and descriptive model of our planning agency needs to address the worry that the norms whose guidance is at work in this model won't be stable under reflection. That's what I aim to do in these lectures, address that worry. Okay. Now, I've been talking about these norms. Let me be a little more precise. The norms of plan consistency include a requirement that what the agent intends be both internally consistent and consistent with his beliefs. It also includes a kind of agglomeration requirement. You need to be able to put your intentions together, your different plans together in a way so that you don't get into inconsistency. What I'm calling the norm of means and coherence is is my version of the hypothetical imperative. If you intend the end, you need to, it's a norm that tells you to intend the known necessary means. We can worry about the fine tuning, and we will later on. It doesn't require that you intend all expected side effects of what you intend, however. That's an important point for other contexts. Now, I also spoke about a stability norm. And this is actually one of the issues that, as I said in the preface, is kind of in the back of these lectures to try to get clear how to think about the rational demands of stability and constancy. In the book, I had these two ideas that I still have that seem right to me, but they don't anymore seem fully sufficient. One is the idea I call the idea of a snowball effect. When you form an intention for the future, frequently it affects the future. So you buy an airplane ticket. Tickets being non-refundable these days, that's a snowball effect. Because now, it might have been a close call between going to Lund and going to Paris, but you already got your ticket to Lund, so now you've got more reason to go to Lund than you have to go to Paris. So call that snowball effects. That's one of the pressures for constancy. Another is that and this is a kind of Herbert Simon point, it is not cost-free to reconsider. It takes time, energy, there's risk of screwing things up. And so frequently there'll be all sorts of reasons why it's not rational to reconsider your intentions, and so long as you don't reconsider, there's a kind of rational stability to stick with it. Okay. All that was the basic picture of the stability of intentions in the book, and what I've come to worry is that that's not yet enough, and you'll see why shortly. Now, let me say one thing about the interaction. So we've got these synchronic norms, consistency and coherence. We've got a diachronic norm, though we don't know what it is, right? But it's a norm of constancy over time of intentions and plans. They're going to interact in ways that I will bracket, mostly, but I think it's important to see. So means and coherence, in particular, says, look, don't intend the end and not intend the known necessary means. It's, as John Broome has taught us, it's a kind of wide scope norm. You can satisfy it either by intending the necessary means or giving up the intended end. There's a kind of normative symmetry. But once you have a stability norm, you've already intended the end. Now there's a kind of normative pressure to stick with the end, so the means and coherence norm, when put together with the stability norm, will give you a kind of normative asymmetry in favor of being means and coherent by settling on the means rather than giving up the end. Okay, so there's this kind of interaction. I'll come back to that briefly at some point. I wanted to note it, but mostly I'll ignore it. Okay, so there's this interaction. Today I'm going to talk about the synchronic plan rationality, consistency and coherence of plans. Now, I take it it's all too possible to be inconsistent or means and incoherent in your plans. I just gave an example about that, you plan to meet your friend for lunch and plan to have your dentist check you out at lunch, right? Well, you can all have your own examples. But that kind of inconsistency or failure to intend the no necessary means, these are violations, according to me, of important rational constraints. And the question is, why? What's the big deal? Now, it's crucial to see that not all pro-attitudes work this way. I walk around Palo Alto and I covet all this wealth. Covet's a great Old Testament term, right? I think it's perfectly okay to covet the wealth and also covet the great joys of the academy when I know I can't get them both. Okay, so there's no consistency problem there. And I could covet the wealth and not have any inclination at all to settle on means. Okay, so coveting, which I take it is a pro-attitude, a lot of pro attitudes work this way. You kind of, it's cool, but you don't have to worry about it. There's too many good things in the world that you think are cool to worry about getting them all being co-realizable, and you don't have to settle on means. So why are intentions and plans different? That's the question. Now you might try to appeal to a kind of, so wait a second, at this point the question is why I didn't change the slide. There we are. Okay, we're getting to the myth. I'll explain that in a second. You might say, well, there's something just intrinsically undesirable about having plans that are inconsistent. But if you just say that, it's not, you run into, it's kind of like, well, why? What's the big deal? Why isn't a concern with plan consistency and coherence a kind of, and this is a term that Niko Kolodny uses, why isn't it just a kind of fetish for mental tidiness? What is the worry exactly? The philosophers who have worried about this in these terms are the ones I mentioned before, Kolodny and Ross, and who have the view that, in fact, these norms really are, the idea that these are fundamental norms of rationality is a kind of myth. This is the view I need to respond to in these lectures. Now, one idea might be, let's see, maybe the way to think about at least means and coherence is it's a kind of principle of transmission of reasons. You have reasons for some end, and then the means-ends relation gets you to reasons for the means. But that's not going to work. Now, to say why it's not going to work and also be useful throughout, I have to say a little bit about this very controversial idea of a reason for action, a normative reason for action. Okay, and there's great controversy here, but here I want to embed what I want to say in the context of the project I've got. The project I got is to try to explain why these norms are going to be reflectively stable for a planning agent. If you're a planning agent reflecting on these norms, your concerns about reasons, one natural way to think about it is going to be concerned with something that satisfies two conditions. One is it's in some ways anchored in your ends, and secondly, they're anchored in ends. Anchored in ends that are desirable, not just anchored in bad ends. So, for the purposes of my talk, I'm going to think of normative reasons as within that kind of dual constraint model. Normative reasons are anchored in the agent's ends. This is a kind of Bernard Williams thought, but they're also anchored at ends that are desirable or good ends. Okay, what's an end? I'm leaving this very underspecified. To have a end is to have a non-instrumental concern of some kind. The crucial thing for me is that ends not all ends are going to be intentions, and since intentions are going to be subject to these kinds of demands for consistency, but you could have lots of ends and there's no big problem given how complicated the world is and having ends that you know aren't co-realizable. I'll let you think of your own examples. And intentions, not all intentions will be ends in the sense I have in mind here, because not all intentions will involve a non-instrumental concern. Many intentions are for things purely instrumentally, and besides, many times you intend things that aren't desirable, so those won't be ends that are desirable. There is a terminological thing to clarify here. When I talked about means and coherence, I said, well, if you intend the end, you got to intend an unnecessary means. The sense of intending an end there, you can intend something as an end without its being an end for you, because you might intend it as an end even though you're only intending it instrumentally. So I intend as an end getting to Lund. Now I have to figure out the means. But I actually only intend to go to Lund, not because it's so intrinsically attractive, which in fact it is, but I mean, you know, but because it's a means of something else. So Lund, getting to Lund isn't my end in the sense of being a non-instrumental concern, but it still might function as an intended end in a sense that sets up a problem of means and coherence. Okay, that's a terminological point. Okay, so the idea is think about reasons as anchored in your ends that are desirable. That seems to me an idea about reasons that would make sense for us if what we're interested in is the agent's reflection on these norms, about whether these norms will be stable under that kind of reflection. You might worry, and a lot of philosophers do worry, and this is a worry that Mark Schroeder calls the worry about too few reasons, that there are going to be reasons, normative reasons, reasons that count. There are going to be reasons that go beyond what might be the ends of the agent. Okay, I leave that open, because for my purposes, If there are further reasons, other than the ones that are anchored in agents' ends, that would be good to know and we need to reflect on. But it seems that I'm thinking the basic structure of my answer to the reflecting agent about why these norms are going to be reflectively stable would just, at most, the worst thing that happened is would help make sense of these planning norms rather than undermine the argument about the reflective stability. Okay, now that's how I'm going to think about normative reasons for the purpose of my discussion. I think when you think about normative reasons this way, you can kind of see it's not going to be just a matter of transfer. Sorry, if you think about normative reasons this way, norms of synchronic plan consistency and coherence won't be just a matter of transfer of these reasons. One way to see that is these are norms on intentions, whether or not what's intended is desirable or is an end of the agents in this tight sense of an end. Take an example I'm going to talk about it in the talks of Iago, who intends to destroy Otello, so he's got an intention in favor of, in this sense, an end, destroying Otello. He's under demands of means and coherence to figure out how to do it, I mean, plus or minus a bit, you know. If reasons are grounded in ends that are desirable, and let's suppose destroying Otello isn't a particularly desirable thing to do, he doesn't have a reason to destroy Otello that's getting transferred or transmitted along means-end lines. Still, he's under some rational demand to get his intentions and plans straight in an instrumental way. Well, there's more to say about this, but I see I'm actually using up more time than I expected. So I think what I'll do is move on and skip over some of the things I was going to say. You might say, well, you know, you might be a kind of quietist at this point. You might say, look, you got to stop somewhere in philosophy. These norms are extremely intuitive. Consistency and coherence of intention. Maybe the idea of stability over time has less intuitive and initial intuitive force. Still, you might say, let's just stop there. You got to stop somewhere. But I hope we don't have to do that. Okay. I would like to. This is what's setting the stage for what I want to do. These norms are playing a big role in the planning theory, but I don't want to just say, that's it. Okay. Why not? Well, why are intentions and plans subject to these norms in a way ordinary desires aren't? I talked about coveting, say. What is going on in the clash with the myth theorists? Is it just a clash of intuitions? I say, well, these norms have a kind of independent significance. They say that's a fetish for mental tightness. I need an answer to that. I can't, okay. There's an idea that's going to play an important role later that these are a kind of system, these norms. Consistency, coherence, stability. There should be some, or I don't know, should may be too strong. Theoretically, it would be good if we could find an underlying commonality that kind of undergirds their force. Good if we had to answer the question, what's the big deal? Why does it matter whether your plans are consistency or coherent? And these kinds of reflections also should help, I'm hoping, with the problem that I said I had in, you know, 10 years ago. Well, it goes back beyond that. I said, well, I had a beginning of way of thinking about the rational demands for constancy, stability of intention over time, namely snowball effects, non-reconsideration. But I'm going to give you some examples today that suggest there's something else going on. And it would be good to see if we can understand the underlying structure under these norms so that it might help us understand better the diachronic stability norm on intentions and plans, which after all is a kind of norm that's trying to get at this glue that ties our thought and action over time together in this way characteristic of planning agents. And most generally, look, I'm supposing that we're reflective planning agents and we're stopping and saying, wow, it bothers me when I intend to go to the dentist and intend to go to have lunch with my friend. That seems a mistake, but why should I shape my thinking according with that norm? That's what the reflective planning agents ask. Is it just a fetish for mental tidiness? Well, I think not, but I want to give an answer. So I'm not satisfied with the kind of quietism. So because of that, you've got 3.5 more lectures to listen to. Okay. Okay. Now, as I anticipated in the preface, some philosophers, in fact, a lot of philosophers, really, it's quite striking how attractive this has been to certain philosophers, have thought, well, actually, the real norms are theoretical. They're on belief consistency, belief coherence, as Harman once said, explanatory coherence of belief. I don't know quite how this works, but stability of belief, well, we're worried about the synchronic case now. Those are the real norms. And as long as you have the right idea of the relation between intention and belief, these are these other philosophers talking, people like David Velleman, Kieran Setia, then you can just think of the norms on intention as piggybacking on the norms of belief. As I said, I call that cognitivism. It gets developed in all sorts of complicated, fascinating ways, and we could talk about it in Q&A, but I can just tell you that, as I said in other work, I just think it doesn't work. There are a number of reasons why, but the basic reason why it seems to me this picture doesn't work is because it's going to be possible to have false beliefs about what you intend. Okay, I'm just assuming the mind's not an open book. You can think you intend to go to the dentist on Tuesday. In fact, your plan was to go on Thursday. So you have a false belief about your own intentions, but if you believe you have an intention, so let's say it's an intention in favor of something that is a necessary means to something else you intend. If you believe you have the intention with respect to the means, your beliefs about yourself, namely, I believe I'm going to perform, get this tooth problem fixed, and a necessary means is going to the dentist, and I believe I do intend to go to the dentist, so my beliefs will all fit together in a nice explanatory picture. Unfortunately, I won't actually intend the means, because my belief about the means is false. So the cognitivist idea that all I have to do is make sure my beliefs are consistent and coherent doesn't ensure that my intentions are going to be means and coherent, because I might actually not intend the means. Okay, so I don't think cognitivism is going to work. So what can we say? Well, let's see, what do I say? Another idea you might have here is what you might call inescapability. The idea is, well, there's a sense in which these norms are kind of not up for grabs. They're kind of built into our thinking. Okay. In a way, I think this is right, in the sense that if you're going to be a planning agent, you need to be, your thought, it's partly constitutive of being a planning agent, that your thinking is guided by these consistency and coherence norm and maybe some kind of stability norm. Okay. The problem is, the problem I call the problem about the multiplicity of agency, and I'm not the only philosopher who's thought about this, it's implicit in, say, Paul Grice's model of creature construction. The idea is there are multiple forms of agency. So the fact that a certain form of thinking is kind of built right into a certain kind of agency, namely planning agency, doesn't tell you that form of thinking is inescapable, because that form of agency isn't inescapable in the sense that you could be an agent and not be a planning agent. And it's clear you could be an agent without being a planning agent. There's great controversy out there with, for example, the primatologists, to take an example, whether the great apes are planning agents, say, okay, whether dogs are planning agents. You can be an agent without being a planning agent. Being a planning agent is a very special kind of agency. We are planning agents, according to me, and that's an important fact about us that helps explain this amazing cross-temporal organization of our lives, but it's not inescapable in the sense of essential to agency. Now, there's another form of this inescapability idea that goes back to Donald Davidson, who was mentioned earlier. And here's this wonderful quote from Davidson. It's only by interpreting a creature as largely in accord with these principles, he's thinking of principles of consistency and coherence, that we can intelligibly attribute propositional attitudes to it. Agent can't fail to comport most of the time with basic norms of rationality. So the idea is the norms of rationality are kind of built into our interpretation of a system as a mental system. Okay. Now, the two reasons I have for thinking that doesn't, I'm perfectly willing to agree with that, but on the one hand, the most it gets you is that you can't have a system that has a mind that violates these norms quite systematically. Davidson saw this. You don't get a prohibition on local violation, you just get a prohibition on extremely widespread violation. Okay. Second, the whole picture Davidson has is really not sensitive to the point I was making before about the multiplicity of agency. This is a picture about minded creatures, which include, well, it's an idiosyncrasy of Davidson's. It didn't include dogs, but according to me, it includes dogs. That it includes non-planning agents. So this is a too high level of abstraction to really get at the relevant norms specific to planning agency. Okay, according to me. So I don't think appeal to inescapability solves our problem. Now, let me turn now to what I'm calling a two-tier pragmatic theory. So this was the picture I had in the book in 1987. And although, and it's actually in many ways, I think the other ideas that I told you about before, that came after the book, ideas about the role of planning in sociality and in self-governance, it's really continued to support this idea that planning structures are really special, they're cool, they're fecund, as I sometimes put it. They enable us to achieve extraordinary things that we couldn't otherwise achieve, cross-temporal organization we couldn't otherwise achieve, social organization we couldn't otherwise achieve. So we can think of these planning structures as kind of universal means, that is, having these modes of thought available to us is a resource for achieving enormously wide range of ends that we care about. Okay, I think that's true, but I don't think it solves our problem, and this was actually something I anticipated in the preface. So it doesn't solve the problem, and I think Smart really did just teach us something here, Jack Smart, this was, that is really it's very difficult to get from the pragmatic value of a general mode of thinking, which is what we're talking about when we're talking about the fecundity of planning agency, to saying that in a particular case, you ought to conform to that general mode of thinking. Because sometimes it looks as if you actually do better by violating that mode of thinking in a particular case. Better with respect to the same kind of pragmatic advantages that are supposed to justify that general mode of thinking. Smart called views that didn't come to terms with this rule worship, okay, famously. It seems to me Smart has taught us something. It's true that there's a strong pragmatic rationale for being a planning agent, but it doesn't solve our problem. It doesn't explain why in a particular case there is something, there's some failure, some rational breakdown in failing to be consistent or coherent in plans. For me, this problem comes up quite vividly with respect to a kind of example that has been on my mind for many years. It's in the book. I'll use a version of this example, a different one than the one I use in the book. Suppose you apply to two law schools, Stanford and Harvard. It's a very American example, I apologize. And suppose you know that they coordinate admissions, so you can get into Stanford and you can get into Harvard. It's not possible to get into Stanford and get into Harvard. It's possible to get into Stanford and possible to get into Harvard, but it's not possible to get into Stanford and get into Harvard. Okay, that's the deal. Okay, you know all this. Now, the smart thing to do in many cases is to apply to each, right? Because maybe we'll get into one. You don't know which one. You're going to let the world decide, as it were, right? Okay. So that's non-negotiable. That's usually the smart thing to do in such a case, unless, you know, special circumstance, okay? So why not say the smart thing to do in such a case is to intend to get into each? After all, if you can get into Harvard, you might say, well, I got in intentionally. It wasn't an accident I got into Harvard. If I got into Stanford, I got in intentionally. So I must have intended to get it to Stanford. I must have intended to get into Harvard, but that violates the consistency constraint. Okay, so there are all sorts of questions this kicks up, but in the present context, the worry is, look, there's a kind of case in which it looks like it's actually a good thing to have inconsistent intentions. So what's the big deal? And the fact that there's a kind of general pragmatic argument for thinking, for kind of generally kind of giving worrying about consistency, doesn't really explain why there's a breakdown in if you intend to get into Stanford, intend to get to Harvard. Now, you might say, so much the worse for the idea that there's a breakdown if you intend to get to Stanford, intend to get to Harvard, and that's going to be something I'm going to try to disabuse you of as these talks go on. Okay, so that sets the stage. So the stage is this. We have this problem. We have some truths here, namely that there really is a pragmatic justification for this general mode of thinking. We also are taking to heart Smart's insight about the fraughtness of the inference from the value of the general way of thinking to the significance in the particular case. We're looking for something to say to a planning agent who's worrying, who's reflecting on these norms that his thinking and her thinking is being guided by. What are we going to say now? We could say, look, being a planning agent is cool. She says in response, yeah, I got it, but why do I have to worry in a particular case? Okay. So now I'm going to say this. Well, what we need to say to that planning agent We're going to help the planning agent in her reflections, right? That's our job. Because what we want to remember, this is all being driven by the worry that if these norms are not reflectively stable, that's going to challenge the whole explanatory structure. Okay. Well, we want to help the planning agent understand why, insofar as these norms of consistency, these synchronic norms, consistency, coherence, why the coherence that they're tracking isn't just mere mental tidiness. That's a response to Ross and Kolodny. We want to give the planning agent a response to Ross and Kolodny, to the myth theorists. We also want to give the, if we can, give the planning agent some way of understanding what's in common across these norms. Now, we may fail there. Maybe there isn't. Maybe that's a, but I think it's a good methodological beginning to look for something in common across these different norms. And we would like to give that to the planning agent to help her in her reflections so she can see that these norms have a basis, they're reflectively stable. And finally, we want to give help the planning agent have an answer to a question that John Broome, more than anyone, has helped us focus on, namely, what reason is there that's systematically present that favors conformity to the norms? Okay. So the thought is that in helping, the planning agent's reflection, we're going to try to give answers to these questions. Offer them. Of course, we're planning agents, so we're doing the reflection for ourselves too. But think of it as helping your friend if it makes it better. Okay. Now, how to do it? Given what I, especially going back to the third concern with reason that favors conformity, and given what I said about reasons as, in this kind of Bernard Williams, kind of qualified Bernard Williams way, as if they're anchored in ends, though ends that are desirable, there's some bells and whistles here, but it looks, the way to think about it would be, well, maybe there's a kind of end that anchors a reason that's systematically present that's a reason for conformity to these norms of consistency and coherence. Okay. In a way, that's what I'm going to end up saying. But there's a kind of short version of this that I don't want to accept. The short version is there's certain ends that are kind of built into agency itself. Constitutive aims, as is sometimes put. Kind of part of what it is to be acting is to be pursuing certain ends or aims. So that seems to me just not plausible. Did I get that quote? No, I didn't. Okay. Agency is just too, potentially erratic a phenomenon. Here's a quote from Jay Wallace that's wonderful. He considers sheer willfulness, stubbornness, lethargy, habit, blind self-assertion, thoughtlessness, various actions expressive of emotional states. This should have been on the PowerPoints. There's just so many kinds of agency with so many flaws out there that we want a general theory of. The idea that they all have a single substantive aim seems to me not a good place, not a plausible way of trying to solve our problem here. So that's not how I'm going to go. So we have a problem, which is we want to be able to satisfy these three desiderata in our discussions with the reflective planning agent. In particular, we want to be able to provide a systematic and present reason in favor of conformity to norms. I'm thinking of reasons as in some ways anchored in ends, desirable ends, but I don't think you can figure out what end it is by finding some end that's kind of built into agency itself. Okay, so I need another strategy. Here I turn to really what is the locus classicus. So Bjorn mentioned the way in which the book I wrote in the work in the 80s kind of changed the landscape. But in fact, it was very much influenced and helped by this kind of groundbreaking book by Gil Harman, Change in View. And Harman also has certain kinds of norms playing a big role in his model of thought and action, and worried about the kind of question we're worrying about. And he offered a kind of reflective equilibrium picture. Say what you do is you engage this process of mutual adjustment of principles to practice and intuitions, kind of try to get a kind of Rawlsian reflective equilibrium. And then he added something, although whether it's an addition or just a kind of elaboration, won't worry about. This is important, he says. We can also consider what rationale there might be for various principles we come up with and can lead to further changes. Okay, so think of it this way. Think, we're worrying about the reflection of a planning agent who's worried about these norms. And we're saying, we're trying to, going to model that reflection, which is our reflection because we're planning agents, okay, as having this kind of dual structure. On the one hand, you're going to try to get a kind of systematic reflective equilibrium of these various norms we're thinking about. But for me, the most important thing, but we're going to look for some rationale for these principles that makes sense of these principles. Okay, that's what the reflective planning agent is. That's our model of the reasoning of the reflective planning agent. That's my model of what we're doing when we're trying to solve this problem. We could think of it this way, that if we're the reflective planning agent, are seeking what I'll call, we're trying to engage in a kind of inference to the best normative explanation. Let's see, what do I do next? Yeah, okay. We're trying to engage in a kind of inference to the best normative explanation. We're trying to think of a systematic way of thinking about these norms and a rationale or rationales that underlies them, that gives me the best normative explanation, the best explanation of why these norms have normative significance. That's what we're doing on behalf of a reflective planning agent. That's what a reflective planning agent is doing. So the idea is we're going to focus on the planning agent who's reflecting on her plan-infused practical thinking, seeking the best normative explanation of thinking. Her thinking is guided by these norms of consistency and coherence. There's some kind of norm of constancy in the background. We're not worrying about that quite yet. And in our reflections here today are on behalf of a reflective planning agent trying to help her. But since we're reflective planning agents, we're trying to help ourselves. So sometimes I'll speak in my own voice, and I'll say, well, this looks like a good explanation. Sometimes I'll say, this is what a reflective planning agent would come up with. I'm taking these as two sides of the same philosophical coin. Okay, so where are we? Okay, so that's kind of how I'm going to proceed. Now, I promise you some examples about constancy, and you'll notice that the way the discussion so far is structured, I've been thinking with you mostly about these synchronic norms, consistency and coherence. But I also mentioned as important, and in fact, in the preface, I emphasize how for me, kind of in some ways, what's one of the main drivers for me of these lectures is to try to get clear about diachronic rationality of planning, the cross-temporal glue, as it were. And remember that one of the things we're trying to, we're trying to give the planning agent a way of thinking about these norms that explains a kind of commonality between the synchronic and diachronic case. So before we go any further, let's think more about the diachronic case. Okay. And remember there, my question was, snowball effect, that seems like just something that's true. When you have a plan, sometimes it changes the world downstream in ways that reinforce the plan. You buy a non-refundable ticket. The Herbert Simon point about non-reconsideration takes time and energy, has risks. That all seems true. Is there reason to think there's something more to say? And that's just a great question in any case, I think, but it's particularly salient given that our approach here, once we're concerned with the commonality desideratum. Okay. Now, there are two kinds of examples that have led me on reflection to think that there needs to be something more to say. The first, I mean, there's each of them, there's kind of a big literature, but the first, I guess, the kind of most visible current discussion is by Richard Holton in his book of his, what is the book called? I forget. Well, it's about willpower. And the example I'll use has to do with alcohol at a party, but I'm sure you can all fill in your favorite temptation. So you know tonight you're going to be at this party. There's going to be lots of alcohol. You're going to be tempted to drink a lot. This morning you're quite confident that would be a bad idea to drink a lot at the party. Maybe you have to give the Pufendorf lectures the next day, something like that. All right, goes back to last evening. But anyway. But you also know that at the party, it's going to look pretty good to drink more. I'm sure you've all had this experience, right? Okay. You also know that after the party, you'd regret it if you drank more. Okay. So this is a structure, the structure of temptation that the humans, and there are all sorts of theories about why these things happen. There's George Ainslie has this, a psychologist has this wonderful theory about how this happens quite systematically. Socrates had a theory, which was very much like Ainslie's actually, about in the Protagoras, about you get real close to the temptation, like being real close to the mountain, and the mountain looms very large, you know, okay. But it happens, okay. And now the question is, if you resolve in the morning not to drink at the party, or not to drink more than one drink at the party, that looks like a perfectly sensible thing to do, and we call sticking with that resolve willpower. And we think it's a kind of expression of human rationality. But it's puzzling, really, because after all, at the party, you're going to think it's better not to go along with your resolve, but to have more to drink. You're going to be quite confident at the party that the best thing to do, best in the sense of with respect to the things that you personally care most about, is to drink. Okay. So how could it be rational to stick with your resolve? Okay. How could willpower be rational? Okay. Now, how could it be rational to follow through with your resolve, is the way I put it there. So that's one question. This is a question about stability, rational stability, whether or not the stability of the resolve, so that you stick with the resolve rather than go with your present evaluation, whether that's a matter of rational stability or just pigheadedness. Okay, that's one question. There's another question that goes to a wonderful discussion of John Broome's about non-comparability case. John discussed Abraham and Isaac with reference to Kierkegaard. I'm going to talk about the young man, his mother, and the Free French, with deference to Jean-Paul Sartre. The point is that, and this is a point John made quite vividly in that paper a while ago, in these kinds of cases, the agent sees himself as making a decision between, as we frequently put it, kind of non-comparable values. So there's mom, there's the Free French. Doesn't think mom trumps the Free French, or Free French trumps mom. Doesn't think they're equal. Think they're two very powerful considerations. There's no way of saying one's better than the other, but he's got to decide. Okay. So suppose he decides on mom. Stay with his mother rather than go fight with the Free French. Now here's the thing about non-comparability. Even if there's some snowball effects, for example, maybe he pays a month's rent to stay with his mother or something like that, important non-comparability cases, the snowball effect is still going to be non-comparable later on. Okay. So a week later, if he asks himself, mom or the Free French, he's going to have the same problem. Okay. Now, it looks like when you're faced with these kinds of choices between non-comparable considerations, rationality is permissive. So, well, one or the other. Okay. You can't do both. Can't be both mom and the Free French, because that's ruled out by the world. But one or the other. But it looks like that's going to be the situation at each, so to speak, along the way. It's going to stay non-comparable, mom and the Free French. You know, go fight with the Free French or help stay with your mom. And if all rationality says, well, do one or the other, there's kind of nothing in the theory that explains what would mean the mistake in what I'll call brute shuffling. Brute shuffling is when you keep shuffling back and forth, brutally, not because there's a kind of shuffling we're all familiar with from iPods, right? That is, you sample lots of different options. That's you're shuffling across. But that's not the kind of shuffling we're talking about here. This is brute, right? You're shuffling between really fundamental decisions, okay? Okay. This is a question about diachronic plant stability. Once he settles on mom, despite the continued non-comparability, is there some kind of rational pressure to stick with that? Okay, so these are two questions about rational stability that get raised by these kind of vivid examples that actually, so mom and the Free French, that's a pretty special case, but if you think about a lot of career decisions, they're going to have a similar feature. Anyone who's counseled undergraduates about career decisions will know that it's almost like mom and the Free French all over again, okay? So these are very puzzling issues about the rational constancy of decision and intention. Okay. I would like it if we could get that, a uniform account of rational stability that that gives us a systematic way of thinking both of those cases, not just one or the other, but both of them. Now, maybe we can't have it, but that's what, you know, in my philosophical prejudice towards generality, that's what I would like. And then, given the commonality constraint, we would like that account of rational stability in these cases also to have an appropriate commonality with our account of the synchronic norms. That's what, if we had all that, and the reflective planning agent had that available to her, that would be the basis for the thought, this makes sense. I can stick with this. This is stable for me. And that's what I need to avoid the challenge that there's a basic instability built into the whole planning theory that's going to undermine its explanatory power. Okay, that's where I want to go. Okay, and now let me tell you about how I'm going to try to do it, and then I'll stop. So now we're stepping back. We're not just looking at the diachronic case. We're looking quite systematically at the various norms of planning agency. We're looking for something to say that goes beyond the two-tier theory, because I'm agreeing with Smart, the two-tier theory doesn't suffice. Here's what I think. And also, we're not going to try to say there's some aim that's constitutive of agency that does the work, because I think that's a will of the wisp. Here's what I think. I think that we do have to appeal to a certain end, but don't try to do it by way of the idea that it's kind of built into agency. And the end or concern is going to be the concern with self-governance. I'm going to try to convince you that a reflective planning agent will be able to appeal to the significance of self-governance to provide the kind of underlying rationale that would support the reflective stability of these planning norms and would also help us make progress with the diachronic case, which is less articulated than the synchronic case. That's the conjecture. So I'm going to try to convince you, now we'll put it in the third person. I could put it in the first person because this is the reflection arming agent, but I'm going to put it in the third person as this reflective planning agent, I'm going to try to convince you, I'm going to give her resources so that she'll think, justifiably, that the best normative explanation of the rational dynamics of her planning agency is grounded in considerations about self-governance. And that will be enough to establish the stability of these norms for her. That's coming attractions. I'm not saying I've argued that. I'm saying that's what I want to do. Now, there are lots of qualifications. Let's see. I think that's it for the slide. Yeah. Oh, I do want to say this. So let's be clear. The idea is not to suppose I had a non-planning agent in front of me. Now, the thing is, non-planning agents tend not to be language users, like dogs or something. So it's a little hard to imagine this. But suppose the there's a non-planning agent who I can communicate with. I'm not imagining I'm going to construct an argument to convince a non-planning agent to change herself into being a planning agent. As if there's a pill, then this could be a kind of, you know, a fairy tale. There's a pill. Take this pill, you'll be a planning agent. I'm not trying to give the non-planning agent the kind of purpose of agent, goal-directed but not planning agent, reason to take the pill. I think there are lots of reasons to take that pill. Those are the reasons that the two-tier theory will track. If you take that pill, you'll have much more kind of cross-temporal structure in your life that will enable you to write books and build buildings and prove theorems and have good temporally extended friendships and all sorts of cool stuff. Those are reasons to take the pill. I'm assuming those reasons are already out there, but that they're not enough because they're kind of that two-tier story. I'm not trying to give more reasons to take that pill. I'm supposing the appeal to self-governance isn't to try to give that kind of reason. What it is we're saying, we're looking now at a person who really is a planning agent, who's being guided by these norms, and we're trying to give her resources to get a rationale, to use Harman's phrase, to which she can appeal to make good sense to herself of this plan-infused practical thinking. Okay, so we've got this planning agent. We're not trying to convince someone to be a planning agent. She's a planning agent. Now, she might get alienated from her planning if she can't figure out whether these norms make good sense. She might come to think Roz and Kalani were right. It's just a fetish for mental tidiness. I'm going to try to convince her that's not true. Okay, that's what we're trying to do with the appeal to self-governance. Now, there are limits here because you might worry, what about a planning agent who doesn't have the capacity for self-governance? Three-year-olds, maybe, okay? Put that aside. It might be that for such an agent, the two-tier theory is the best we can do, okay? I think, but you might want to challenge me on this, that with respect to the challenge I'm worried about, it's enough to convince you that if you have a planning agent with the capacity for self-governance, the rational dynamics of your agency will be reflectively stable. Why do I say that? Because, remember, the worry I'm worried about, the primary worry is, if I can't make sense of these norms as a planning agent, then, I mean, I might not be able to get rid of them. That's what Tversky and Kahneman taught us. There are all sorts of kind of things we can't get rid of, like affirming the consequent and ignoring base rates and all that. But still, I would like the structures of planning agencies not to be kind of one of these glitches that Tversky and Kahneman have identified, right? The myth theorist looks at that and says, aha, it's just a fetish for mental tidiness, so, you know, if you can get rid of it, you probably should, and it doesn't make much sense, really. That's what I'm worrying is going to undermine the stability of the planning system, the stability of which is very important for its explanatory power. Okay, so it seems to me it's a reasonable answer to that worry to say, well, at least if you're a planning agent with the capacity for self-governance, it's going to be reflectively stable. And because most of the planning agents we're worrying about, like us, have this capacity for self-governance, and so our planning agency will be reflectively stable. Okay, so the fact that my effort to provide a normative, a kind of underlying rationale for these norms depends on appealing to an agent who has the capacity for self-governance seems to me okay. Okay, so that's where I'm going. We've got a lot of work to do. We need to say something. I've just talked about self-governance, but what's that? I need to tell you more about how I want to think about self-governance. I want it to be a naturalistically embeddable phenomenon, not something that involves some self from outside pulling the strings and doing the governing. Okay, I want a kind of naturalistically plausible model of human self-governance. I need to explain how that might connect up with these norms in ways that would help the reflective planning agent respond to those three desiderata. And that's what I need to do. And that's what I'm going to start doing in the next lecture. Thanks.
Thanks. I have a question concerning your view on normative reason. And I was wondering, as I understood it, you said a normative reason has something to do with an end being desirable.
Yeah.
That seems fine to me in many ways. But I just wonder if you look upon desirable in a sort of analogy with the distinction between good and good for. So what you're asking is that the reason, the end should be desirable for the agent, or if it's desirable, period. And I think that's actually an important distinction to mm-hmm. have in mind mm-hmm. when you talk about normative mm-hmm. reasons. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, because later on, for instance, you described your reason in a way that suggested to me that it's not desirable you have in mind, but rather desirable for.
The reason I'm a little nervous about that is I want to be able to retain the critical significance of saying he's got a reason to do it. So I want to be able to say about Iago that he doesn't have a normative reason to deceive Otello. He certainly has an end. I don't know what to say about whether achieving that end is desirable for Iago. I'm comfortable with what to say, at least I'll take it as given, that it's not a desirable end to achieve. So that's why I'd be nervous I want to be able, I think that's why I think I want to stick with what I said rather than change it in the way you suggested.
Did you recognize that there is the possibility of both?
Yes.
So you might have two kind of
reasons. The worry I have is, I'm not sure how it's going to turn out. Is it going to turn out that destroying Otello is good for Iago?
That's open for discussion.
Yes, right. I know these are big questions, yeah. Right? And there are a lot of big questions that I've been I'm sure it will be clear. I'm trying to get at my questions, and without having to solve a lot of questions, other questions that I don't know how to solve. So that's why I've kept it in that generic way. But it's a perfectly fair question. Yeah.
Ingvar, you also.
I would like to put forward a question about how you look at non-planning agency. I have no critical remarks to what you have said about planning agency, but some thoughts popped up. So, about what about non-planning agency? Are you prepared to divide them by different kind of classificatory labels, such as spontaneous actions, habitual actions, absent-minded actions? Are all these kinds of actions or the agency behind them examples of non-planning agency?
The divide between being a planning agent and non-planning agent is whether or not your practical thinking that shapes your action involves settling on temporally extended plans that then shape your thought and action over time in a way that's characteristic of us. That's how we get to Lund, for example. Okay. And I'm supposing you could be an agent without that kind of structure in your thinking. I think young children, probably dogs, and for all I know, Martians. I mean, you know, I haven't met a Martian, but it's, you know. It seems to me you could, even if you're not a planning agent, we could ask whether or not you're thoughtful in action or not, or I forget the particular categories you had in mind, but so someone might just be a non-planning agent who just kind of acts on the spur of the moment, but you also might be thoughtful and be a non-planning agent. It's just that you don't settle on future-directed plans, but you're very thoughtful about what to do right now, so you stop and think.
To my thought that there must be a kind of classifications,
yeah,
of non-planning agency.
I actually think the classifications you gave is probably cross-cut. Yeah. That is, what were the three you gave me?
Spontaneous actions, habitual actions, and absent-minded actions.
Yeah, I think my direct answer to the question is both planning and non-planning agents could be, you could have instances of each kind of action. If you're a planning agent, you could still act spontaneous if you're a planning agent, though that wouldn't be itself a kind of expression of your planning agency, but it's you still, if you're being a planning agent, is a kind of capacity, so you could act spontaneously, you could act habitually, you could act, what was the third, I'm sorry?
Absent-mindedly.
As a planning agent, I know for sure you can be a planning agent who acts absent-mindedly. So I think those will cross-cut. So the direct answer to the question is, even if you just had purposive but not planning agents, you would want to be able to hold on to those kinds of distinctions and others as well. So the proposal is not that this is kind of the only big distinction we can make across agents. There's also a distinction between good and bad agents, or, you know, there is, I think your question helps me say something that it is important to me. There is a conjecture, and it's part of this, and the conjecture is kind of at the heart of the thought that I said in the beginning, that I think of this story about planning agency as this is not just for philosophers. This is a conjecture about a very systematic feature of certain kinds of agents, of whom we are that, but it may be, if Tomasello is right, the great apes are too, that there's this fundamental capacity that helps explain cross-temporal organization and other things as well that's really important. It doesn't displace all other distinctions, but it also isn't just a kind of small distinction, right? It's really a basic distinction, yeah, according to me. And you know, that's a theoretical conjecture that has to earn the right to be accepted by its use in understanding and explaining all sorts of stuff. And that's why I think, for example, the planning theory is not just for philosophers. Yeah.
Thank you. I'm sorry I'm late. I was late, incidentally. Forgive me for that. You're talking about agency and practical rationality. And you're looking for something that underlies it, something that explains what the principles of practical rationality are going to be, how they encourage coherence, what they have in common, and what's normative about them, why we should pursue them. And the principle you're going to offer us is self-governance.
Now, that's part of the story, okay. But yes. Mm-hmm.
But now these are only part of rationality. Mm-hmm. And though you reject cognitivism, so you don't think practical rationality reduces to theoretical rationality, you presumably do think there is such a thing as theoretical rationality. Right. And presumably it too has something in common with practical rationality. Yeah. So are we to expect what you say about practical rationality and self-governance to tell us about theoretical rationality too and what it has in common with practical rationality? Yeah. Or are we to expect there's going to be something quite different from practical to explain theoretical rationality? Yeah. And if so, isn't that rather puzzling?
I don't have a settled answer, but I'm inclined in favor of the second option you gave me. So it doesn't work to collapse in the direction of the theoretical. That's what I argued. I'd be surprised if it works to collapse in the direction of the practical. In a way, that was the, you know, Dewey, Peirce, and such, in a way, had that idea.
I think that's a two, incidentally. I mean, Davidson is using this idea of rationality to interpret creatures, but they've got to be acting in order to do it.
Yeah. So, yeah, so there might be... I think I don't know the answer to the question, basically, because I haven't figured out what I really think about that. I know some pieces that the collapse in the direction of the theoretical doesn't work. I also think, insofar as Davidson has a kind of picture of these rationality norms as kind of the most abstract form of coherence and consistency across both the practical and the theoretical, as I said, I think as a theory of interpretation, I am not taking issue with that, but it is a theory of interpretation of minded creatures that doesn't tell us anything special about the norms that are at work in planning agency. This actually gets back in many ways, because he was a very systematic philosopher about this. This, when you think about the point that Bjorn made right at the beginning, so Davidson's views about intention changed over the years, but they never played a deep role in rationality. He started to open up a little bit beyond the kind of view that Bjorn alluded to in the introduction. But it never really, the theory of rationality didn't really grab onto them in any serious way. So that very abstract structure that's built into interpretation doesn't really grapple with my problems. That said, I think it's one of the really puzzling things about what to say, about theoretical, about these rationality demands on belief, given that you don't think you're going to get, they're not going to be connected in one direction that the cognitivists want, and that it's, and then I'm not sure you're going to make it work in the other direction either. So I think you just put your finger on one of the unanswered features of the view. But okay, I don't see that as an objection. I see that as an insight.
I'm not offering it as an objection, of course, but it is going to leave us with a puzzle then, because
That's
it's surely pretty clear that we don't call these things just rationality for nothing. They do have something in common.
That's right.
There is something that brings them together.
Yeah.
And so if you've got an account of one half of it, and maybe there's another account of the other half, then we've still got something missing. We've got to link those two things together in some way.
I agree. And so I just think that's maybe not the $64, but the $32 question, and I'm at the $16 level right now. If it's also damn hard, right? I mean, if I succeeded in these lectures in convincing you that there is this distinctive normative structure underlying these planning norms, but it's distinctively practical, it's concerned with self-governance. I mean, the two-tier stuff's floating on top, right? Right. In a way, that's at least a prima facie response to the challenge to the planning theory that the whole thing's unstable. Okay, but it raises your question. If we ended up being completely befuddled about how to answer your question, then that might come back and haunt me. I agree. So that's as far as I've been able to get. Yeah.
I have a small question about one of your arguments. I'm not sure I got it right, but when you talked about diachronic rationality, you said that the snowball effect and the cost of reconsideration is not these things are not sufficient to explain.
Worry. These examples raise the question that those considerations, which still have force, don't exhaust a systematic account of the diachronic rational glue. Mm. Yeah.
I thought that one of your objections was that this would not account for the rationality of sticking to one's resolutions as in the case of your sticking to your resolution yesterday evening, for instance. And in that case, that seems plausible. But it seems to me that the value of sticking to resolutions just varies from case to case.
Yes.
I mean, in some cases, we would consider a person who was sticking to his resolutions in spite of strong reasons to change his mind just as irrational. So it seems to me that there is no general value in being resolute.
Yeah, that's a great question. And I basically agree with the premise, but not the inference. That is, I do not want a theory that explains why it's always rational to stick to your resolutions, because that would be a terrible theory. It's not always rational to stick to your resolutions. Okay. We're not prisoners of the past, rational prisoners of our past. Okay. What I want is a kind of theoretical framework within which I can make progress understanding why sometimes it's a rational failure not to stick with your resolutions, where the explanation of the rational failure isn't the snowball effect and you wasted time and energy reconsidering. Okay. That's what I'm going to try to provide over these lectures, among other things, is a way of thinking about what's going on in willpower, that you could see a kind of systematic rational pressure for sticking to your resolution, but it can be overridden. And so there's no assumption that it's always rational to stick to your resolutions, but the worry is we don't yet, if all we've got are snowball effects, rational pressures against reconsideration, and the idea that there's a kind of presumption, a rational presumption, that given that you think it's better to drink, if that's all we got, then we don't have the theoretical resources to kind of get at some systematic rational pressure to stick with your resolution, even if many times, you, on balance, it doesn't make sense to stick to your resolution. So I'm basically, as I said, I accept your premise, but the inference I want to draw is not that there isn't any distinctive rational pressure over and above the snowball effect of non-reconsideration for willpower. It's that whatever it is in a way defeasible. And I'll actually, what I'll end up saying in the lectures fits that.
Do we have any other questions? Yes? Whit.
Thank you. Is the type of rationale that you're hoping to provide the reflective agent, which is a planning agent, is it something that comes from the same rationale for not taking a pill that will make him a non-planning agent?
I'm sorry, these things are getting in my ears.
Okay. Suppose there's a pill that could make a planning agent become a non-planning agent.
Yeah, okay, right,
So is what you're aiming for a rationale against that, which will then you could use for the particular cases to provide some sort of protanto reasons or the feasible reasons?
That's great. That's good. That's a very helpful question. I'm not sure exactly how I should answer it. I'm assuming that there's pretty good reason to take that pill if it gets you to be a planning agent you weren't, and there's pretty good reason not to take the pill if you give up your planning agency by taking it. Okay, and that's all kind of built into the two-tier pragmatic story about how cool planning agency is. In a way, I'm giving the planning agent another reason not to take the pill, the reverse pill, let's call it. Okay, but so let me see. The way I'm thinking of it is this: she's worried that though there's the kind of these kind of good general effects of this system of thinking, when it comes to the particular case, she doesn't see what the force is of the norms. So why can't I have inconsistent intentions if that's a good way of achieving my ends? That's the kind of, why can't I both intend to get into Harvard and intend to get into Stanford? Okay. So I want to help her explain to herself let's put it this way. I'm assuming she's being guided by norms of consistency that see inconsistent intentions as a mistake, a glitch. Okay, she's worried that she's been listening to Niko Kolodny, and she's worried that she just has this fetish. Okay, so I'm going to say, well, actually, I'm going to try to give her something that allows her to think it's not a fetish. It makes complete sense because it's part of this larger package that's tied, that involves an appeal to self-governance, a package that I haven't described to you, but I'm alluding to. Okay, so on the one hand, that's also a reason not to take that pill, the reverse pill, because her system of thought makes sense to her. She doesn't need to take the pill to avoid thinking of herself as just being guided by a fetish. Okay. On the other hand, maybe there is no other hand. I mean, it just insofar as there might have been pressure to take the reverse pill because when she reflects, she thinks what she's doing doesn't make any sense really at the particular level, it might make sense kind of in general to think these ways, but in a particular level, if I can do better by being inconsistent, I'll be inconsistent. I wanted to block that worry on her behalf, right? It's not only that the system itself pays, it's that in each particular case, when you apply the system, there's something normatively at stake that it actually is something that you can make sense of and buy into, that explains why in the particular case it makes sense to stick to the norms. So you don't have to give that up. So in a way, it's arguing against the reverse pill, but in this but in a different way than just kind of adding to the kind of general considerations in favor of being this kind of agent. Does that help? That's a great question, though, because I realize it actually mirrors some worries I had about exactly what's going on. But it's going to come out. Okay, so good. Thanks. Yeah.